Hello and welcome to Newsclick's International Roundup. Today, we discuss the situation in West Asia and the Persian Gulf in the aftermath of the attack on two tankers in the Gulf of Oman. To talk more about this, we have with us Prabir Purkayastha. Hello, Prabir. So, Prabir, as we know, the two tankers were attacked a couple of days ago, and the US has been quick to claim that Iran is responsible for this incident. And we also know that last month, there were similarly attacks on four tankers off the UAE coast. So how do you evaluate these claims and what is the reason for it?
Well, of course, very difficult to figure out who has really attacked whom. At least whom is more clear, right? Because they're going to Japan, they're owned by different organizations, but it's clear the attempt is to also make everybody realize how vulnerable the tanker movement in that region can be. Right. That's one possible scenario. Other possible scenario is that this is a false flag operation. The US has earlier done this, the famous one being Gulf of Tonkin. Then we had the other example, the Iraq war itself, where they said in 45 minutes or something, WMDs can hit parts of West Asia. All of that shows that the false flag operations do take place, and they take place in different parts of the world. And the US has a history of doing this. So therefore, is it possible that, like the Iraq WMD scare, that Iran is doing all of this is actually an attempt to create a warlike condition and possibly attack Iran? In this, there has also been arguments that the US, shall we say, the military, the State Department, the NSA, and the Trump administration's different factions of it have different attitudes to the war, a war in Iran. And Bolton, who has been the one who's been talking about, at different points of time, bombing Iran back to Stone Age kind of rhetoric, and who's also been pushing the war rhetoric, war against Iran rhetoric very hard, also claiming that various intelligence agencies, which essentially appear to be Israeli intelligence agency, because the Americans don't seem to have come to this conclusion, is Iran is preparing for war, is going to attack. So all of this put together, this is a possibility that this is a false flag attack, which the Americans, or what the Iranian foreign minister has said earlier, a B team, right? In which case it's very clear which the B team is. It's Israel, it's United Arab Emirates, it's Saudi Arabia. This is the B team that they're talking about. The B team mounting this attack, hoping to draw America in. Right. On the American side, tacit support from Bolton and others who want to really go to war in Iran. This is one possible scenario. The other scenario, and I'm not going to say that anybody sitting at this point can really say which scenario is the correct one, is that Iran, while realizing that there are attempts to actually build up a war campaign, war hysteria, which may lead to attacks by the United States and Iran, is also firing salvos across the bows to warn them that if there is a war in this region, that Iran has the ability to strike, and if they do strike, then it will really lead to a total disruption of the shall we say, the tanker movement in Hormuz. As earlier also Iran has warned that if we don't export oil, nobody else will through Straits of Hormuz. The one reason why I think this is not so likely, if we look at the tankers which have been affected, they're pretty close to the shores of Iran. And it would mean that if they really did get hold, and again, when you make a strike like this, it's always possible that you would lead to puncturing of the hull and large amounts of leakage. It affects Iran much more than anybody else. It's quite close to the coast. Now, US military has released some photographs or videos showing that there is an Iranian petrol boat which went and removed a limpet mine. The Japanese owners of one of the ships have made very clear that they do not believe it was a limpet mine that was used in the attack. They seem to believe that it was actually a torpedo, or it could also be a drone which could be used to attack. So they don't seem to give cognizance to the limpet mine theory, which is what the US has been talking about by showing that video. The Iranian boats came, removed the limpet mine because that didn't explode. So those are still open issues, what really happened. But I'm surprised at one point, which I think one of the observers has pointed out, that why is nobody asking for a United Nations Security Council-led investigations of the whole scene for this particular two tankers that we are talking about and find out what really has happened? Why not put up a multinational task force also whose whole sole task would be determining who has actually done this or who could be possibly responsible for this, and why was this not done in the earlier tanker cases also, where again off the coast of United Arab Emirates, Fujairah, this happened. And there also such a demand was not made. Instead, went straight into saber rattling. While it must also be recognized, well, the US is a B team, so does Iran have a B team in the area. They're not controlled by Iran directly, but there are the Houthis who have their own axe to grind against Saudi Arabia. And there is also Hezbollah, there is also Syria, and there is also sections in Iraq. So Iran is not without allies in the region. So I think we have to really, at this stage, say, while it's quite possible this is a false flag attack meant to ratchet up the war hysteria, possibly under the aegis of Israel and Saudi Arabia and United Arab Emirates, or it could be warning shots by Iran. At the moment, we don't have evidence to show either way. But yes, the US record would seem to indicate that US is quite possible. It's quite possible sections in the US State Department in connivance with others, or with other sections with the Trump administration, is also interested in creating incidents which then can be used for war. We can see the war rhetoric has been ratcheted up considerably. And that is something which is very dangerous for the world.
And to take a step back and look at the larger picture, so to speak. So what is the relevance of the Straits of Hormuz specifically in this context, and also in the context of the global tanker flow? Because that has been the subject, a core point of the discussions that have been taking place around this issue.
If you go to the picture of the tanker movements, you will see in the Straits of Hormuz, this is where we are talking about, the very, very thick density of the tankers that go through this area. In a larger context, I think almost 20% of the world's oil flows through the Straits of Hormuz. It has a number of oil-producing nations on its, shall we say, bordering the Straits of Hormuz. And because it's a choke point, it can be very easily stopped by any military action, by any player on that side. Of course, Iran holds a very important position because it abuts the Straits of Hormuz. So for it to stop the Straits of Hormuz, all tanker traffic is very easy. Given the number of tankers going there are two risks that is there. If, for instance, there are this kind of unknown players attacking the tankers. Now, if they sink, of course, huge pollution that will take place, destroy large amounts of coastline on that area, it will be a marine disaster of a major magnitude. But apart from that, the other issues that would immediately take place is it push up the cost of a tanker hiring, and it also push up considerably the insurance charges. So it would immediately push up the cost of oil significantly in the international market. We can already see the cost of oil, or the price of oil, having jumped post these attacks. So I think these are two very important considerations. And the point is, if there is any war in this region, it's not that you now have a, shall we say, a scenario where Iran will not be able to do anything vis-a-vis United States. The issue is that it's much easier for an attacking force to create vulnerability for tanker movements. And it's very difficult for the United States to stop this completely. Because you talk about fast boats, which are really light. Therefore, they're very maneuverable, quick, and can definitely sink a tanker fairly easily. You have underwater submarines, again, which can do various things. So there's a whole range of now possibilities, including ground-to-air, sea missiles, which also can be used by Iran. So Iran's strike power against tankers is pretty large. If you want to take that out, you have to really do what Bolton was claiming, bomb Iran back to Stone Age. And if you do that, then its aircraft carriers, etc., are also vulnerable to missile strikes. And on top of that, it's also true that there are about 20,000 American troops within missile range of Iran. So can they take all of this out without damaging the tanker flows or their air bases or their land bases? This is the question. And I think this is really dicing with death. And it will take out some amount of American infrastructure in the region. It will inflict body bags, which is something the United States today doesn't want to face. And more importantly, it can really paralyze the traffic in the Straits of Hormuz. And a 20% drop of the oil flow in the Straits of Hormuz has horrendous implications for the rest of the world.
So basically what we are seeing is once again oil becoming a major deciding factor in this crisis. And it's also important because China is also another country which is going to be massively influenced, considering Iran, it's one of the largest importers of Iranian oil. And the global supply chain, as we see, is actually under threat in some senses.
Absolutely. You see, this has been what has shored up the American dollar. Not that Americans required oil for actually domestic consumption, which partly now they have overcome, and also they're exporters today. And fracking has provided a major element to that. Now, I'm not going to get into how the fracking oil, how viable it is, and so on. There are different debates going on about that. But nevertheless, today the U.S. is actually oil surplus economy. What has really made U.S. grip over the global economy so strong is the fact that the oil is denominated largely in dollars. So unless it is exchange trade, which Iran might be able to do, or a couple of other countries do, it's really the international price of oil being pegged to the dollar, which has given dollar essentially the position of a reserve currency of the world. And being the reserve currency of the world, its ability therefore to impose sanctions on any country in the world, and that's what we are seeing at the moment, that all these countries, companies are coming into the orbit of sanctions because of the ability of the US to control the dollar and therefore identify any entity that does not obey the sanctions could be brought under its heel because they have to still exchange dollars, they will be vulnerable to it. So if we look at the oil scenario, 20% of oil passes to the choke point of Straits of Hormuz. So supposing that stops, there are no easy solutions in sight. Even the pipelines which are there could at the most take about additional 5%, and they still would not be able to reach the destination that we currently see it reach. So what we are going to see is a huge impact, particularly in countries like India, China, Japan, and Korea. These are the countries which would be affected. Of course, you have also Indonesia, Malaysia, and others. So, but the major impact is really going to be in these four countries. They are the major oil guzzlers, and particularly India and China and Japan. These are the three countries which would be most affected. So the choke point of Hormuz is very important for these countries. But also, if you have a 20 to 15% drop in oil production, your oil price could go through the roof, and we do not know where it would stop, because every country will be then vying for surplus oil. And that would actually be a major blow to the global economy. People have said it could go to $200, $250, but certainly if 20% of oil flow stops, you are likely to see a global recession and at least oil prices in the region of $120 to $150. The argument, of course, that others have given, that the US, apart from the Iranian issue, taking out Iran as a regional player, strategic player in the region, has also a subsidiary interest, because that makes the fracking oil far more competitive than it is today. I do not believe these wars are really being fought on the economic basis. I think really what it is being fought on is the fact that Iran is a strategic player in the region, Russia having coming back to the region, that Iran therefore has greater, shall we say, maneuverability. and strategic autonomy than it had earlier. And this is what is changing the, shall we say, the rules of the game in West Asia. And the dominance that US had post-90s in that region is slipping. And this would mean that the dollar denomination of the oil, that may no longer hold. And if that breaks, then the US ability to control the global economy would slip. And that's the region they really want to take out Iran at this stage. Whether they're willing to take the risk of the kind of disaster which will take place in the rest of the world, and whether the rest of the world has any will or leverage vis-a-vis the United States, this is the open question.
Thank you, Prabir. That's all we have time for today. Keep watching Newsclick.